Hello friends, you are welcome to our literary channel Academic Domain. Today I am going to discuss the poem On His Blindness by John Milton. It will be line by line explanation of the poem in English language. Friends, if you haven't subscribed my channel yet, please subscribe it and press the bell icon to get notified my new videos. Like, share and comment so that others will be benefited. So the points I am going to cover in this video are number one, about the poet John Milton. Next point is, there will be some important works of the poet. The third one, some points about the poem. And the fourth one will be line by line explanation of the poem in English language. So let's discuss few points about the poet, John Milton. John Milton, he was born in 1608 and died in 1674, was an English poet, polemicist and man of letters. He was a voracious reader, traveler, wrote poetry mostly for private circulation and launched a career as a pamphleteer. Wrote in English, Latin, Greek and Italian, he achieved international renown within his lifetime. So he became international, he became famous at international level in his lifetime. He was so fair that he was called the Lady of Christ's College. So these are some poetic works of John Milton. One is On the Morning of Christ's Nativity, which was published in 1629. It is a poem. The next poem is On Arriving at the Age of 23. The next poem is L'Allegro, published in 1632. The next one is Il Penseroso, published in 1632. The next poem is Lycidas. The next one, an epic work, that is Paradise Lost, and another epic, Paradise Regained. So these are the poetic works composed by John Milton. So here are some plays by, some plays and prose work by John Milton. First one is A Mask, presented at Ludlow Castle, 1634. A play which is commonly known as Camus, which was published in 1634. Next one is Samson Agonistes, again a play published in 1671. The another very important prose work is Areopagitica. It is a prose work on freedom of speech and freedom of press. So there are so many poetic and prose works by John Milton, but I have mentioned here very important, most important, a very few works. So let's discuss few points about the poem. It is an autobiographical sonnet in which Milton meditates on his own loss of sight. So we know that John Milton was blinded, he became blind at the age of 44. So in this poem, he is thinking or meditating about his own eyesight, that he lost his eyesight, and he is thinking about that. It is written in Petrarchan form. So we know that there are two types of sonnets in English literature. One is the Petrarchan form and another is the Shakespearean or the English sonnet. So Shakespearean sonnets contains three stanza and one couplet. Each stanza contains four lines. So Shakespearean sonnet contains three quatrain and one couplet. While Petrarchan sonnet contains one octave and one sestave. One octave contains 8 lines and sestet contains 6 lines. So 8 plus 6, 14. A sonnet used to be of 14 lines. So this poem, On His Blindness by John Milton, is a sonnet which is based on Petrarchan form. The octave rhyme schemes are A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A. So the rhyme scheme of the octave of this sonnet is A, B, B, A, A, B, B, A. And the rhyme scheme of sestet is C, D, E, C, D, E. So, the first stanza of the poem goes like this. When I consider how my light is spent, ere half my days in this dark world and wide, and that one talent which is death to hide, lodged with me useless, though my soul more bent. So, here he became totally blind. Poet became totally blind, and when he became blind, he is not able to see the world, and he is not able to perform his duties like other people in the world. So he is thinking here that when I consider, whenever I think that how my life is spent, how I became blind, ere half my days, before half of my life. So he became blind at the age of 44. That's why he is telling that before half of my life I became blind, and so when I think that how my light is gone, how my that eyesight is gone, so he seems, you know, very sad when he think about it. Is in this dark world and wide. So the word for John Milton is a dark world. It is a dark and wide, because he's not able to see anything because he became blind. And that one talent which is death to hide, and he is telling that he has one talent. One talent is that is poetic talent. So he says that I have poetic talent, and for that I want to serve my God. I want to serve my Maker. And that one talent and this one talent, this poetic talent which I cannot hide. Hiding poetic talent, hiding my talent is like a death for me. So he is telling that, and lodged with me useless. So this my poetic talent is useless for me now, because I am not able to use my talent now. Though my soul more bent to serve there with my Maker. Though my soul more bent to serve there with my Maker. Though I want to serve my Maker, I want to serve my God with my talent, but I am not able to serve him. I am not able to appreciate him. I am not able to adore him, because I became blind. And present my true account, lest he returning child. And again, there is a fear in the mind of or in the heart of poet, and he says that, and present my true account on the day of judgment. He is telling that on the day of judgment, he lest returning child, he may rebuke me. He may send me back, and he may chide me that you didn't serve me, you didn't appreciate me, you didn't adore me. That's why there is a kind of fear in the heart of the poet, that on the day of judgment he may rebuke me, my Maker God may rebuke me, and he may send me back. So again he is thinking that doth God exact day labor light denied. He is again questioning. He questions himself that doth God exact day labor light denied? Does God expect the same labor from a blind man? I fondly ask. And the poet says that I fondly ask. I used to ask myself. I used to question myself that doth God exact or expect the same labor, same hard work from a blind man? But patience to prevent, but my patience to prevent that murmur, and my patience to prevent that murmur. When I murmur myself, when I question myself, so my patience replies me to prevent my murmur, to prevent my grief. My patience replies me, soon replies what? God doth not need either man's work or his own gifts. The patience of the poet, the patience of the Milton, or the conscience of the Milton, that replies him that God doth not need either man's work or his own gifts. God doesn't need anything. He has bestowed a lot of things to the human being. He had given everything to the human being. On return of that, he doesn't want anything from the man. He doesn't want anything from human being. He doesn't want anything for his gifts. So God does not need either man's work or his own gifts. So God does not need anything. Who best bear his mild yoke, they serve him best. So his conscience, his patience replies Milton that who best bear his mild yoke, the people who are tolerating, the people who are happy in every situation, they are the best servant. So who best bear his mild yoke? The people who are, you know, bearing or tolerating all kind of situation with the same attitude, with the same mentality. They are the best servant of God. They are serving him best. His estate is kingly. So the estate of the God is kingly. He is like a king. Thousands at his bidding speed and post over land and ocean without rest. Thousands of angels at his bidding speed. They are just running here and there. They are busy in their duty. Thousands of angels are always busy day and night. They are busy to fulfill their responsibilities. So there are thousands of angels to work for God. They are always busy in to fulfill their responsibilities, to fulfill their duties, and post over land and ocean without rest. And thousands of angels, they are posted on the land and on the ocean without rest. Always they are working, they are doing one thing or the other thing, day and night they are busy to fulfill their duties. So God has thousands and lots of angels to work for him. So that's why he does not need man's work or anything for his gifts he has given to the human being. They also serve who only stand and wait. So he says that those angels also serve God who are waiting for their turn. It means that it doesn't mean that they are not serving him. They are not doing anything, so they don't serve. It doesn't mean that. Though they are waiting for their duties, they are waiting for their turn, so still they serve him, still they serve God.